That was great. He's been really kind of, wow. So you can't fall asleep with all that food and sugar in you. That was fantastic. I'm sure you seem... So you're going to get back to that lady, and I'm sure you're very happy to answer questions afterwards or on another occasion. Right, I'm now going to move to the panel behind me. That was a very odd thing to do. I felt like I needed music and there wasn't any. Somebody could have done a little bit of... I felt very silent. Right, so I am now going to invite the great and the good to join me here for our first debate, which is entitled How to Strengthen Local Governance for Separate Collection, Recycling and Material Recovery. So please rise and ascend the stairs. We have Jakob Simonsen, who is MD of the Danish Waste Association and VP of Municipal Waste Europe. You're welcome to applaud if you have the energy to applaud. Feel free. Gunter Langer of VKU, German Public Waste Management Companies, Chair of Working Group Waste Eurocities. We've got Helmut Maurer, I beg your pardon. I think that was better. DG Environment European Commission. And instead of Françoise Bonnet, we have Philippe Michaud, who is project manager at ACR Plus, which is an international network of cities and regions with a shared aim of promoting smart resource consumption and sustainable management of municipal waste. We have Emmanuel Katrakis, who is Secretary General of the European Recycling Industries Confederation. Somewhere? Oh, wow. Oh, you're doing the long walk of fame, shame, something. Keep clapping. He's not there yet. Yeah, thank you very much. I like that. That's the real rock star wave from way at the back of the room. Thank you so much. We've also got Piotr Bartzak, Waste Policy Officer of the European Environmental Bureau. Thank you. We just heard from you, Mr. Trendy Twitter person. And we also have Henrik Listad, who is Chair of the European Compost Network. Hello to you. Do we have that? Ah, we've got the clicker. So... Welcome one and all. Do you know, I was about to say, I had a thing in my script saying, ladies, we may be outnumbered, we'll not be outclassed, but there we go. There is no other lady, so never mind. Oh dear. Seven panelists, about an hour, 50 minutes, 1 hour. I'd like each of you in turn to please offer up your initial top line thoughts on the theme of local governance in a crisp 3 minutes. You've seen how bossy I am. I'd like you to stick to your time just so that these good people, it seems that there are a lot of questions that people want to ask, and I'd like to give them the chance to do that, to put you guys on the spot or to have their say. So Jakob Simonsen, can we start with you, please?
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to all of you. Well, to start, we have seen a lot of different collection systems today, and I think it's fair to say that that one way that municipalities has to work with introducing and increasing recycling is to work with the infrastructure. And of course, when we talk about infrastructure, we are talking about services of general interest, because this has to be done not only for few persons, but for all persons in the municipality. What is very important in this, and why it's also a service of general interest, is that we have to make something sensible out of when we have collected all the materials that we do. We don't have to focus on collecting for the sake of collecting. We have to focus on making new products from the things that we collect. So quality recycling, please. And at the core of our focus should, of course, be our customers. That we have heard throughout the day or this morning. But the customers in our shop is very different. Some are very positive and some are more negative towards what we are throwing at them in terms of recycling systems and so on. Sorry. That is to say that some people also use our systems in this way. And this is a part of our everyday life, so when we supply systems, they need to be robust. And that is also why it has to be a clear and well-defined public task to develop these systems, because when the systems are not used as we want them to be, then you have to fix the problem. It's not all about attitude, because a lot of young people have the right attitudes toward climate, towards recycling, towards everything else, Some of these people we actually see coming to the rock concert in Roskilde every year. They all have the same and very good and positive views, but when the party is over, I'm sorry, it looks like this. And that is why it needs to be extreme robust systems, and also why we need to think differently. This is, of course, a bit of an extreme example, but it goes to the core of what our job is. Our job is to get this big pile of ill-defined materials and try to separate it onto smaller piles of well-defined materials that can actually be recycled for something sensible. So what we need is flow control. We need to have flow control to say where we can put the waste. We can use the market when the market actually provides good solutions, or we can do it ourselves in sorting plants or whatsoever. Of course, it goes to the money. We need to have adequate financial instruments to make this happen, because recycling, as we've heard today, is a cost. And if you don't have a means to cover the cost, nothing will happen. So you need financial instrument. So bottom line is clear public responsibility, please. Thank you.
Thank you. When we were looking at that picture and then you were talking about sort of the separation and the recycling of different elements, I thought, did you include some of those very drunk people there? We're going to go down some kind of channel as well.
Well, I think it's very important to say that we have very sensible people like all of you and very drunk people as customers in our systems. And we need to be able to provide a service to all of them.
And then, No,
we're not recycling them, I think.
Thank you very much for that. And now I turn to Gunter Langer of Eurocities. Your thoughts, please.
Okay.
Oops, press again.
Okay, thank you for inviting me. And we have heard a lot of examples and a lot of good examples what municipalities are doing. And if you want to see a nice experience, I have also with me a small DVD where Munich also has a good example. But I want to be more general. When I started to thinking about what I tell, I said, if a fairy is inside the room, what are the three wishes I want to have for municipalities to strengthen in the circular economy? Three wishes. The first wish is knowledge exchange. The second one is money. Everybody needs money. And the third one is reliability. I will put it in detail. The first is knowledge exchange. When we are sitting here, most of the people know each other. We know it, we tell about good examples, we tell each other good examples, but what are with the municipalities who are not in this room, who have not access to information? Some colleagues in other municipalities or smaller local entities says, you always can go to Brussels because you are working in a big company, in a big city like Munich. We have no access to any information. And I think it's also for member states who are the not so good performer. So my idea or my wish will be a knowledge platform who is accessible for all municipalities. It could be funded via EU, it could be funded from everywhere, I don't know, but it must be accessible for all municipalities and for all local entities. And though we are in the thing of way of money, all the examples we saw were made by cities or municipalities who had a waste fee or has a tax. But what's about the others who don't have a tax or have no funding or such a thing? There must be also a way for financing it. Maybe the member states should be forced to have legislations for laws or for taxes, or maybe over EPR schemes. So EPR schemes should help municipalities via funding to make their good business, their good work. And the last thing is reliability. That means if we have a quality standard for second raw material, then we can do green procurement. Because we say, okay, it's worse when we buy a waste bin from old plastics. It could be interesting. It could be an interesting experience. If this bin is crashed and fall into your truck, you have a problem. So there must be some quality standards. There must be also a reliability in law. It shouldn't change every time. It should be now. Maybe the circular economy is one straight way. And then we can say, okay, we invest, we can do it, and we have the chance to tell the people, reliable, what they have to do. And this is my three wishes for the ferry. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Three wishes very concisely put. Helmut, may I turn to you for the European Commission? Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I'm happy to see that you're all still awake and numerous, so that's very good. Local governance, have you seen any minister here? There's no minister here. You can have a wonderful minister, you can have wonderful laws, you can have a wonderful waste management plan, and it doesn't change anything if you don't have a local governance. On that area where things actually happen, where the waste arises, etc. So that is really, and we've seen today, and that's the fascinating thing about this conference, local governance in action. You've seen examples of local governance. You've seen what works, what doesn't work, what works better than other, and so on, and what mixes of systems we have. Laws in itself are aspirations and only paper. This all needs to be organized on local level in the first place, and everything depends on how well this is done there. And what I've taken so far from today's conference and other studies on this topic is there are some success factors, why things work or don't work, and I think the first would be to organize the process. Telling your citizens they shall do this and that and not providing the infrastructure is useless, and you better don't say anything. So we see examples where infrastructure is perfect. I know from Milan, and visited Milan some time ago, they have an information campaign, six approaches in six different languages to address every and each citizen who is not an Italian to identify and to see that this is a common issue that they have to engage in as well. That is so important, and it means organizing the process. Inform the citizens constantly. It's not just saying once and saying, oh, come on, folks, we have changed the system, inform yourself and leave us alone. No, this is a constant process of working with citizens together to make them the issue their issue. And I think that's the most important. If people do not identify, you can punish them, you can threaten them, nothing will change. Only if they identify, things changes, and that needs homework. And give them a financial incentive, finally. And we've seen all these impressive pay-as-you-throw systems. They are precisely based on that principle. People do the work at home and they learn. They learn by experience that if I do that properly, I have little residual waste. It's being picked up, its weight, I pay for that. And the less residual waste I have, the more I have separated before, the better it is for my purse. And that pays. And that is an excellent example. We had some this morning, and I suppose a brilliant example of working local governance. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Philippe. I hope you're going to be as good as your colleague who isn't here. No pressure would have been.
I'll try. Thank you. So at Asia Plus, we definitely agree with the Committee of the Regions and its statement this morning telling us that selective collection and waste management should be considered into a broader perspective of resource efficiency and circular economy. Regarding separate collection, well, we've seen this morning all the ingredients of the recipe, and there is a need to speed up now the process in order to reach high performances. There is a need of shared responsibility with the citizens. Citizens are consumers. We could call us citizumers instead of citizens and consumers. Shared of responsibility with the producers as well, so that they design products that are reusable, repairable, more easily dismantleable, and therefore allowing a more easier separate collection. And also, there is a need of political commitment to take the right decisions and to use the right instruments. Those instruments can be legal, for instance, separate collection of wet and dry fraction. That's one thing. Targets are a key driver as well, also for waste prevention. We've seen that it influences as well separate collection when you set target for waste prevention. Economic instruments, pay-as-you-throw, we've seen that already. Good examples, ACR Plus will release a report on pay-as-you-throw in March. Taxes on the lower levels of the waste hierarchy, so that you can also incentivize recycling. EPR schemes with minimal harmonized criteria and platforms to discuss these criteria. Technical instruments like a mix of door-to-door collection, bring banks and civic amenity sites, mobile and in facilities. And also communication, awareness-raising campaigns, also on waste prevention again, and I encourage everybody to take part in the European Week for Waste Reduction is implemented every year and since 2009, I believe. There is a need of tool to allow to evaluate policies and to make benchmarking and not using four methodologies as it's possible for now or two methodologies as it's proposed in the new circular economy package. At ICR Plus, we've been working with our members for years now on that, and we've ended up in a methodology, a harmonized methodology, DREC, Destination Recycling, that is implemented in several territories in Europe now, and that can be that can allow fair comparison with a single way of calculating the recycling, the selective collection rate that goes to recycling. And in the end, we indeed need to share information and good practices, and that's what we have been doing at ACR Plus for years. We have launched last year a database of circular economy good practices that also provides examples of selective collection and recycling activities successfully implemented in Europe. You are all welcome to use that tool. Thank you.
Thank you. Emmanuel Kataracis of the European Recycling Industries Confederation.
Thank you very much for giving me the floor, and thank you very much for the organizers. The first point that I was willing to say within 3 minutes is that indeed recycling companies are our strong supporters of separate collections, and because it has been very well proved today, separate collection is an enabler of quality recycling. It minimizes cross-contamination and consequently it increases the value and the recyclability of separately collected fractions. So in that quest of stronger separate collection, we are very strong allies. Now I would like to develop 3 ideas, and most of them have been already depicted. The first one is responsibility. Responsibility in separate collection is absolutely crucial, and indeed it's a shared responsibility of all of us. Citizens, public authorities, private sector, to support compliance with separate collection requirements. One area where I think more could be done together with municipalities, and many examples have been shown today, is information and education to ensure that anybody knows what happened to their waste and understand the importance of proper separate collection for recycling. The second point, which is also crucial, is the waste hierarchy. I think this is something which has been well depicted in the new package. Investment decisions need to be made on a long-term basis, and it's absolutely crucial to ensure that they align with the waste hierarchy to avoid bottleneck situations witnessed in certain instances today where recyclables collected separately end up in treatment facilities which are lower in the waste hierarchy. The third key point is to guarantee the involvement of the private sector in separate collection, as the private sector offers optimized and cost-effective solutions to collect, sort, transport, to collect transport sorts and recycle resources. And that we do that on an everyday basis. So just to bridge it with the very last point, while the operational decisions on how to implement separate collections must be made at local level, and this has been very well shown today, in accordance with subsidiarity, it's equally important to ensure that this will not translate into too stringent proximity principle, and that we are going to think at the end of the pipe, because at the end of the pipe we need to have a well-functioning market for secondary raw materials in Europe. And this is, I think, also extremely important. Thank you.
I just say they're all being very obedient, aren't they? You see, that it's very impressive that everybody's going through, like, woof, laser sharp. Okay, so over to you, Piotr Bartzak of the European Environmental Bureau.
Thank you very much. 3 minutes, 3 points, and 3 tweets from everybody, so we make Twitter explode. Yes, how to help local authorities? Well, I have 3 points for you. First is we have to take care of the loopholes in the EU legislation, and here I will talk about TEEP. TEEP, not TTIP, and commingled collection. All right. Sorry for that. Another point is this one solution, one suggestion, my favorite. And I will finish by showing you a couple of graphs, two graphs actually. So first, the loopholes. You know the TEEP, it's in the Article 22 of the Waste Framework Directive. Member states shall ensure biowaste separate collection where TEEP. It means technically, environmentally, and economically practicable and appropriate. It is a clear weakening of the previous proposal. It shows now the loophole. And it seems quite easy to implement. Okay, it facilitates implementation, but how uncertain this formulation is. I used to work at the Ministry of Environment in Poland, and I know that our local authorities use every possibility to use the loophole to waive their obligation. So if we want to help local authorities to improve separate collection, we have to get rid of these loopholes. But in the same time, we know that the blind obligation can be easily circumvented by, for example, putting one wheelie bin in the center of the town and saying now for biowaste collection and saying, oh, look, we are now running a separate collection of biowaste. So we have to be careful here. Another one is commingled collection, separate collection by commingling. And this is something that does not prevent impurities, and that was already talked about that today, and it's totally blind to waste prevention. One solution from me and one suggestion that was already mentioned by Paul from GRC is the ceiling, the threshold of a maximum amount of residual waste per capita per year. This is something that is, according to us, a more intelligent way to address the heterogeneity of the situation in different member states. This approach does not only boost separate collection, gives this a necessity for separate collection, but also boosts all the efforts for reduction of total waste generation. Any tools for that? Well, penalties would be the tools, but my favorite is pay-as-you-throw, P-A-T. That was explained, I will not explain, but this is something that can work. And also another one, rebates. Rebates, for example, for home composting. Whoever does home composting should have a rebate in tax in the fee of waste management. And these are the two graphs that in real life show you how it can look in practice. This is an example from Kapanori, and it shows that only within 10 years they managed to reduce their total waste generation by 39%, and they boosted separate collection to 82%. And I know a lot of municipalities say, hey, come on, but it costs a lot. But this graph should show you that it's not true. It speaks for itself. Well, if local authorities invest more in separate collection, the actual and total cost of waste management drops down. And these are 5 examples from different parts of Italy where you can see clearly that cost can be reduced if the separate collection is better managed. Thank you very much. That's from me. Thank you.
And to you, sir, at the end, Henrik, chair of the European Compost Network. Yeah, you've got the clicker. Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the invitation to share some ideas from the biowaste sector. While waiting for that, I can mention that alongside being a chair for ECN on the daily basis, I'm the assisting director of Waste Management Norway. ECN is a member organization, a network for organic waste recycling sector in Europe, representing about 2,500 biological treatment plants with more than 30 million annual ton capacity. Both composting plants and anaerobic digestion plants are covered, and the plants are in public as well as in private ownership. I think when it comes to When it comes to the role of biowaste, I must say I'm very pleased to see that this conference is maybe the conference where I have heard the name biowaste and separate collection most times outside my own events, so to say. So this slide is maybe unnecessarily, but I think it is still important just to remind ourselves of the benefits of organic recycling. First of all, it closes the loop, reducing the linear economy of landfilling of biowaste. But from day one, and in the biowaste sector, this has been the case for more than 20 years. We produce bio-based products, being compost, being digestate, being biogas, replacing products such as peat, mineral fertilizer, fossil fuels, and so on. And another effect that has been recognized by the Commission, by also the Ella McCarthy Foundation just recently, is that by source separating biowaste, you actually enable an improved recycling of the dry residuals, because taking out the wet material makes it much more easy to go technical sorting of what the source separation cannot do on itself. So this is what we like to call a Norwegian source separation 2.0. And at the end, of course, we are talking about creating jobs, creating growth. It speaks for itself that when you produce growing media out of garden waste, you need more labor than if you exploit some peatland up in Estonia, Finland, or Norway. And the same applies, of course, for biofuels, for vehicles, in comparison to oil and gas. Okay. One slide more. What figures that were made is that the potential for jobs is around 20 to 50,000, and I think these figures are conservatives. These are based on the fact that today we are recycling about 30 million tons of biowaste in Europe, but there are 100 million tons out there being wasted each year. So there's a huge potential, and you see here on this slide the status, so to say. This is based on the ECN questionnaire. Okay, I leave the policy recommendation for the discussion. It's obvious that we want more clear mandatory separate collection of the biowaste in Article 22. We think there should be some date into this article, and we want to see some binding recycling targets for biowaste in Article 11 as well. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much for that very comprehensive overview from all of you. Just before I turn to the floor, was there anybody on the panel who particularly wanted to comment on, expand on, come back on something that another person, anything that sprung out from that somebody else's 3 minutes that you wanted to know? Yes, of course, go on.
It's more a clarification. Mm-hmm. When I spoke about the maximum ceiling of the residuals per capita in the waste bin, I meant in kilograms. In kilograms, it is much better than in percentage, because in this way we can actually show that in countries that produce less waste in total, their residual waste is also smaller than even in Denmark, where they produce a lot of waste, but they have zero landfill or something like that. So kilograms would be a better solution. We can discuss about that. Thank you.
Okay, so we know the focus. We're really focusing on local governance. You've heard a lot of different ideas. Who'd like to kick us off? Who's got enough energy? The gentleman here, yes.
Michele Giavini from the Italian Composting Association. Just a consideration, following up on what Piotr was saying about TEP. That's really making the case, because As you know, for bio-waste collection, there is no EPR scheme. There are no incentives. There isn't anything, basically. But it is working, and it's working very well. So what's the sense of having a TEP statement in a framework in which, basically, if there is a minimum incentives, it works. If there is no incentives, it works anyway. And environmentally speaking, it is, according to many LCA studies, it is correctly going on. So we are supportive on the fact of that bio-waste collection is always feasible anywhere.
Did anybody want to, do you want to come back? I mean, it's important.
I totally agree. I totally agree. Just one thing I also didn't mention in my presentation, but we don't want to kill home composting as well. And whenever it is better and there are opportunities to compost at home, we should give this opportunity because it's environmentally better than to run a truck around the town or around the village and collect this waste. So I think there is a way to be flexible on that, but I also would like to hear why the TEEP is there from the Commission. Thank you.
First of all, if I turn to Jakob.
A few comments. Firstly, regarding home composting, I think we have many studies showing that home composting is actually not very good. The emittance of methane is quite substantial. And therefore, if you want to compost, you should do it in central sites. So we do not want to really promote home composting in that way. You also have an idea about putting a cap on residual waste. I think the first thing then we have to agree on is how to calculate residual waste. It is correct that we in Denmark have quite a lot of waste, produce a lot of waste, but we calculate it in a different way than many other European countries do. So let's start by making a uniform calculation method, and then we can talk about other political instruments after that. Because if we just start by doing this now, it's like comparing apple and pears, and it will not bring us forward. Thank you.
Thank you. I will just come in here. I mean, you had posed the question about, you know, there's a loophole. Shouldn't we get rid of the loophole? Why it's there? Do you want to say anything on that, Monsieur from the European Commission? Hello? Yeah. Oh, was that I'm reflecting or I'm just ignoring you so I don't have to jump in there. The question's out there, so the loophole, the issue of it being a loophole, shouldn't we just get rid of it? Why is it there?
What would be the loophole?
Well, do you want to come back? You had said there's this technical element. It's a loophole. If you don't make it obligatory, then people are just going to use that as a loophole.
You mean separate collection obligatory? Well, what do you want to make obligatory?
The TEP. The fact that the TEP is not
the TEP.
The TEP is separate collection of bio-waste.
Sorry, do you want, instead of us all, okay. Pose your question again directly to her so that we...
That was also a question for Sarah there, but it's the thing that by having TEP, we open door to for authorities to waive their obligation, to escape from the obligation. That's it. Yeah, thank you. Okay, it's Article 22, Waste Framework Directive. Member states shall ensure bio-waste separate collection where technically, environmentally, economically practicable and appropriate.
Well, let's deal with that one quite swiftly then. Okay.
Oh, thank you very much. That's very interesting that you have already invented an abbreviation for this. I'm so sorry that I could not follow this rapidity of... Actually, this clause is one of the most misunderstood and misinterpreted, I should think, that is out there, and it's not new either, because we have it in Article 11 of the Waste Framework Directive already. I think it's misinterpreted because it's sometimes understood by some as a kind of allowance to just invent any reason why they can't do a separate collection or for bio-waste or any other waste. And that it's economically not feasible. That's not at all what the Court of Justice has confirmed in many judgments, not particularly on this question, but on generically on similar questions. Economic feasibility is basically irrelevant. It becomes relevant under exceptional circumstances, and those exceptional circumstances can be invoked. But not as a general rule to excuse that someone doesn't want to do a separate collection of bio-waste or any other waste.
Okay, thank you. I think, did you want to come in again?
Yes, thank you very much. I think this question about separate collection of bio-waste is a very, very complicated one because it comes down to what is the alternative treatment method of bio-waste. And it also comes down to then how much energy can you make out of the bio-waste and what's the alternative energy that you can make in other treatment methods, for example, waste-to-energy plants. And then, for example, in Denmark, we have a lot of waste-to-energy capacity, but it is linked to the district heating system. It's combined heat and power plants, which are extremely more efficient, and they are actually more efficient in an energy sense of way than the biogasification plants. We can get 3 times as much heat out of the waste-to-energy plant than of the biogasification plant in Denmark. And so if we only look at it from the energy point of view, then it is probably better to burn the organic waste than to put it to a biogasification plant. But if you look at the challenges that we have in the transport sector, it can probably be very clever and very good to make gas so you can run heavy vehicles on gas. But that induces that you have to upgrade the gas when you get it. And therefore, public authorities are moving on this agenda. And I think it's very sensible that they move on this agenda. But it's not easy just to say that one is better than the other because it's not possible to do that.
Okay, just to come in and then we're going to close this avenue. Yes, Henrik.
It's just on Jakob's remark that organic waste gives more energy in incineration plants than in biogas plants, and I think for the most LCAs being made, this is the opposite is the case. And for normal organic food waste, municipal waste, you produce more energy by implementing anaerobic digestion. But I do agree that it is important to steer towards good utilization of the energy biogas, and the local governance has great opportunities to steer towards vehicle fuel utilization. They can demand biogas buses, for instance, refuse trucks driven going on biogas. It's all there out there and available.
Okay, I'm going to throw it back. Thank you very much. I'm now going to put it back out there to you. Yes? No, I'm not, apparently. Are you going to round up? Yes? Yeah. Go on.
Okay, I'm back to my wishes. Why should they do it? Why should the municipality buy a biogas bus? Why should they do it? Because the diesel is very good. In Munich we have tried it, and it wasn't working very well. So if there's no incentive or such a thing, then there is no way to do it. And the other thing is, what we are now discussing is a very technical thing. Yeah, okay, is it better to make a digestion? Is it better to compost? But the real question is, why should the municipality do it? Why always should the municipality do it? Why should what is the purpose for it? Just why we like it? No. There must be a real purpose why we should do it. We can do it if we have enough money. We can do it if we have fees. But all the others who are not so good performant, and you see how much landfilling is in Europe, what should they do? So even they are not here, they are not talking about composting, they're just landfilling. This is, I think, the main issue for circular economy, not our highly sophisticated decision. I can also tell something about what we are doing, but I think it's not the purpose. The problem is really to help the others who are not so good performing, to help them. This is my idea.
Okay, I'm going to stop you now. I'm going to come now. I am this time because I'm bossy, as we all know. I'm going to come back to the audience. So please come in. I mean, on that, but I'd like to sort of to finish there. You had your three wishes. You talked about knowledge exchange. You talked about money. You talked about reliability. We had a comment there about, you know, the systems have to be well used. We had a comment, I think it was from you. Yes, it was from you. You talked about, you know, where can more be done? Certainly, and that came up earlier, information on what has happened to waste, which seems to be which was raised earlier. The waste hierarchy is important. So, come on, the floor is yours. Yes, the gentleman at the back.
Graham Holder, Flexible Packaging Europe. I was just observing that even the experts in the front don't necessarily agree on which is the best technologies. So I'm forced to ask the question, well, how to strengthen local government for separate waste collection and material recovery? I have to go back to Mr. Langer's statement about knowledge exchange. I mean, we do need to identify as experts what is best practice, make this available, we should actually take away the responsibility for local authorities to necessarily question what is best practice. If I have a dinner party with friends and I tell them I'm in the waste management area in packaging, I get lots of expertise around the table from people who don't even work in the area. And so I do question as to how do we move forward, and this is a general question to the panel really, how do we move forward with a package of information that is rubber stamped so that local authorities can take it as gospel and implement it as appropriate in their area?
I will turn to the gentleman on my right first. You've been very silent.
Thank you. As I mentioned, ACRPS has been working in helping cities and regions for 20 years now to improve their waste management and resource strategies. So you're welcome to come to us. We launched last year a specific initiative on circular economy with guidelines to help cities and regions to improve or implement or develop new circular economy strategies. Highlighting business models that could fit their situation. We published a database of cases and examples and good practices on circular economies, including waste management, selective collection, waste prevention. So this is one of the tools that is available to all public authorities.
Mark Lindert from City of Düsseldorf. When the question is how to strengthen local government governance, I think there should be a bunch of measures. We have heard about cities humors. Günther talked about green procurement. Emmanuel talked about a market for secondary resources. So it's all about the question, what can we do with all this separately collected stuff? And I think it's necessary first for the municipalities to combine waste management and procurement, so which means the people dealing with both of these parts shall sit together. And the commission should deliver information on regulations on what is a good product to be used, produce better threshold values maybe, and for example also strengthen the work on labeling good products and taking recycling into the labeling of good products maybe for this EU eco label, this eco flower.
Anybody like to comment? Would you? Yes?
I think it's very difficult. I understand the wish that it would be very nice if one size could fit all, and that if we could just make one system that we could all follow. But it's the world is more complicated than that. And that is also why Henrik and I can have an exchange of numbers regarding treatment methods. Because waste-to-energy plants in Denmark are very close to the district heating system and are utilizing all energy, whereas in southern Europe they may only be producing electricity. So it's not as good an option in southern Europe as it is in northern Europe. And so there's not one size that will fit all in this system. I think that's also one of the strengths of local government. Local government is there to see that the option that they do can make sense for the people. Because only if we make recycling sensible for the people, then they could see what they actually give into the systems, what they give us to work with, actually produce new products. Then we get the legitimacy to keep on working. But if we just collect and then don't do anything clever with the things that we have collected, then we will lose this legitimacy. And that is, in many cases, what we are actually in some parts of the system doing today. We are producing goods to a market that is not there, for example, for the plastics. It's only a small part of the plastics that can actually be reused. Right, and the rest we are collecting, and we cannot make new plastic products out of it because plastic is hugely complicated material, and it's hard.
Yeah, thank you. Regarding the, I agree with what you said, Jacob, that there is no one solution fits for all. You need to take all the ingredients and make your own recipe according to your local situation. Regarding the public procurement instrument specifically, there are ways indeed for the local and regional authorities to influence strongly the market. Public authorities' spendings accounts for approximately 20% of the EU GDP per year. So this is the public authorities are really a strong actor that can influence the market, and they have several instruments in terms of public procurement, either investing in green products, that's green public procurement, or also investing in technologies that are more resource efficient, that's public procurement of innovation in the field of waste management. And those two instruments are very essential in the portfolio of the economic instruments that are in the hands of the public authorities. Of course, it's public money. Public money don't fall from the trees. But it's related also to the public and political commitments that the local authorities must take. They have the responsibility to deal with the fact that in the coming years we have scarcer and scarcer resources. So even if diesel, for instance, at the time being is at a low price, and that is also a constraint for the plastic recycling industries, but fossil fuels will not end forever, and that's the same for material resources. So we have now to take to face the challenge and take the good political decisions that will help to face this scarcity and growing scarcity of materials.
Yes, I would like to reflect on two points. First, the issue of bio-waste and separate collection. One of the arguments why separate collection of bio-waste would help is also, as it was shown, that then we get higher performance for the dry fractions. But, I mean, there was a really interesting question behind this, which was basically if we separately collect, it's going to cost money. And then we have, again, to think about the markets for secondary materials. Those are the two feet which go together. So especially for bio-waste, which is a market in development, compost, we need indeed to have eventually end-of-waste criteria or standards, so that they can be marketed, penetrate the internal market, find the right incentives. Those have been done for, I would say, traditional resource streams, metals, paper, which compete on a global basis. Today, the prices of commodities are extremely low. The situation of the recycling businesses is extremely difficult. But if we want then to have the right measures to separately collect, to increase the recyclability of the resources that are collected, we need indeed to find the way to have well-functioning market for secondary raw materials. The second point was related to information. And when we think about information, we always need to think about who is the target. And the target here is not the experts which are in this room, who are in this room. It is, I would say, the new generation, or the generation which is going to, or the generation which is existing today. And here I believe that more vertical way of communicating through social media, storytelling, showing that recycled raw materials can substitute primaries, that we can make new product out of that, a way which is very direct, which enters into the space of citizens, might be also the way to educate.
Okay. We've got about 5 minutes. Who, yes, the lady here.
Thank you. My name is Ella Stengler from CWEB. We've heard a lot of splendid talks today, particularly about targets, but targets are not an end in itself. What I was missing a little bit was talking about public health and environment, and shouldn't we focus more on that? If I hear about a cap for residual waste, Piotr, what if you have waste which cannot be used in a healthy and environmentally sound way, if you have a fixed cap? So I think we should focus a little bit more on public health and environmental issues in the discussion.
Well, I agree very much with Ella. I think when we talk about circular economy, there's a few things that we must make very clear. We need to have clean streams of uncomplicated or unpolluted materials that we want to recycle. And then we should promote recycling of these materials to every day, every single day, and just more of it. But I think the real challenge is that we have a lot of complicated materials in our society. And the complexity is rising. The amount of chemicals in our fabrics and in our compounds is rising. 20 years ago, or maybe 30 years ago, there was not made Gore-Tex. It's a wonderful material if you go hiking. I love it. But it's very, very hard to treat in a good way. My shoes, they have a membrane of Gore-Tex in them, right? How do we split this apart? It's a wonderful shoe because it keeps my foot warm and dry and everything, and it's wonderful. But it's just very, very hard to recycle. And therefore, we need to think about how can we recycle things, how can we make clean streams of materials. That's the core of it. And therefore, we need to have all parts of the waste management system in play. That is also actually landfilling. Of course, we cannot just landfill mixed materials, but we need to develop a good strategy of landfilling complicated materials that we do not want in our stream of materials. We need waste-to-energy plants to take out the sink of pollutants, and we need a lot more recycling of the uncomplicated materials that does not pose a threat of health in the society. So we need to look into all strings, and we cannot just say we recycle more and we save the planet, because we are not able to do that.
Can I take a last? Not sure if they were clapping what you said or they were clapping the fact that you obviously do yoga. I'm not sure that. Yes, do you want to come in there?
Very shortly. I observe for quite a while that I'm getting more and more irritated because we're not talking about our subject anymore. This is about strengthening local governance for separate collection. And what I just heard was extremely interesting, but I can't relate it to the subject. But since you said it, I think I need to have a little word, because in the circular economy communication, which you may have read already, you find a lot of hints underlining that what you say is right, basically. And the European Commission has set in place now a set of action they want to follow to change exactly this, to look into product design, how to tackle this complexity and how to make this all more coherent so that things can, at the end of their useful life, also be recycled. But again, strengthening local governance on the circular collection. I just had a brilliant idea. I think I wonder myself why waste management plans, national waste management plans, apparently, or maybe they do and I don't know it, but apparently don't address appropriately the local level. They address all kinds of things, but they address less how to, let's say, finance separate collection for municipalities or communes or regions in the country, or some may, but it doesn't seem to be a generic characteristic. But would be a good idea, perhaps, to think about this, to amend waste management plans, precisely to help regions and local governments to put in place the infrastructure they need, which has a cost factor to it.
On the light of that, and I'd like to keep your can we keep your question focused? If it's not focused on what we're talking about, then I'm going to move on. Yes, we're good? God, you look terrified.
Oh, sorry for that. No, I think it fits very well. I totally disagree with the comments from Mr. Maurer that we are off topic, because I think we are very much on topic. At this moment, municipalities are cleaning up the mess of others. We are still at the end of the pipe, as Jacob demonstrated with his shoes. And yes, indeed, in the circular economy package, there are lots of measures and activities announced to tackle this. This is very good, but there's one very important message missing. And that is that if we really want to engage into a circular economy in Europe, the inevitable consequence is that we should not allow that in the future products are put on the market which are not recyclable. And I think that is a statement that the Commission needs to make. That's my comment.
Indeed. I think we are going to move more onto that in the next debate, but thank you very much for the comment. We're pretty much at time now, and I want to leave time, so I'm going to park it there. I'm going to say thank you very much to all of you. I hope you can actually get down the stairs now and haven't done yourself any damage. Thank you very much to all of you, Henrik, Piotr, Emmanuel, Philippe, Helmut, Gunther, and Jakob. Thank you. A warm round of applause, please, for our panellists. Okay, you're still with us. We've got one more. I think it's been quite nicely timed. You've just got one more debate now, and then you've got a nice, rousing, closing speech. So we are on the home stretch, but it's an important one. We're still focusing on implementation. This time around, we are asking the question, how can producer response... Can you just keep it down as you go back to your seats, guys? Thank you. How can producer responsibility and separate collection support quality recycling and maximising material recovery? So, these lovely ladies, hopefully it's in the order that I have. First of all, may I welcome, please, to ascend to the panel, Nicolas Garnier, MD of Amorce and VP of Municipal Waste Europe. Where are you, sir? Oh, you're also far, far away. You're going over there. Welcome. And may I also welcome Hakon Jentoft, Chair of the Working Group Waste at Eurocities. Warm welcome to you. No, we're good. And may I also ask for Martin Herzeg, Head of EU and International Consulting at the Copenhagen Resource Institute. Welcome back. You can give him a round of applause. Okay, he can have two. Joachim Coden, Managing Director of the Extended Producers Responsibility Alliance. Monsieur. Thank you very much. A round of applause. You have to keep clapping till he gets here. Yes, well, you can do all your razzle. Michael Len, who is Director of Reuse, a Brussels-based organisation representing social enterprises, active in reuse, repair and recycling. I think your motto is second hand first, if I'm correct. We've got Antonis Mavropoulos, who is a global waste expert and member of the board of the International Solid Waste Association. Somewhere? No? Is he with us? He's not with us? Speak now, forever hold your peace? No. Okay. And we've got Virginia Janssens, who's Managing Director of the European Organisation for Packaging and the Environment. Hello. So, you can remove this gentleman, please, and move Virginia up, because he's too terrified, clearly, to sit on this panel. He's run away. So, welcome one and all. We're in good time. Seven panellists, 1 hour. I think the first lot of panellists did it very well. So you are in the hot seat very first. And the next 3 minutes are yours. And please remember, this is what we're looking at. Producer responsibility in separate collection. How can that support quality recycling and maximising material recovery?
Thank you, Katrina. As you know, France is not a European champion of soccer, but we are a champion in ERP, Extended Responsibility Producers. We have, I think, 13 ERP in France. And first, I would like to ask you some questions about your life, if you accept it. Do you like sport?
You
look
at me.
Yeah. What do you think we are going to do with your old racket, tennis racket, when she's broken?
That's not such a good choice, because tennis isn't one of them. I don't know. Make it into a colander to put spaghetti through.
And then you like do-it-yourself?
Yes.
Some painting, for example?
Yes.
Do you know what we are going to do with a brush, with whole brush with a lot of painting? Landfill. And so on and so on. Dishes and so on and so on. In fact, the first problem is... why in our waste litter we have about one-third which is recyclable products, one third is organic, and one third is the dark side of the moon. I mean, products, thousands of products, we don't talk about when we talk about recycling. And the question is, why don't we have recycled solution for that? And the answer is, first, because the producers did not think about the end of life of his product. My dream is to have a discussion with Mr. Mattel. You know Mr. Mattel? He's the make who made the little fair blonde little woman in plastic. I would like to know if when he products that Mattel, that Barbie, he thinks about the end of life of the Barbie. I think no. And the second problem is because when he product his toys, did he think about using recyclable materials? I don't think Barbie is made with a whole bottle of plastic. I don't think so. The third thing is, when you are going to buy a Barbie, do you think that the father or mother know if the Barbie is recyclable? No, you don't know, because it's not written on the product. And then, when you put it on the litter, do you know that you are going to pay for that? And you are going to be taxed for that, because there is a landfill tax in quite all the country. No, you don't know that. That's the reason why we think that CRP is the main solution for recycling in that European, in Europe, sorry. And the question for us, I would like to talk the question to the Commission. What do you think of racket, dishes, do-it-yourself, brush, Barbie, in your directive? Because in fact, when you say in the directive, on the future directive, we have to develop ERP, but each country can do what he wants. In fact, you say, we don't want much more ERP. And if you don't want more ERP, you don't want eco-conception, you don't want information, good information on each product, not on only packaging, only some of the product, in all the product. And the last question, who is going to pay? Because in fact, 10% of the cost of the waste in Europe is paid by some of the ERP in all the waste, not only in packaging. In packaging, it's a good student, in fact. It's about 40, 50%. But in all waste, it's only 10%. Because, in fact, 90% is paid by the local incomes. The local incomes. And there is no real matter and no fair, no equity about that. So the real question of the directive is, do we want a ERP in Europe in each product, because for each product we need to think about circular economy, not only packaging.
Oh, yeah, you can. Yes, you can. Yes, thank you. Can I now turn to the gentleman on your left, please, from EuroCities. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is, as we said, Håkon Jentoff from EuroCities, but also from the city of Oslo. We had a discussion last day on the proposal from the Commission, and I will say a little bit more positive to the Commission on the EPR. We think that extended producer responsibility is among the most important measures introduced in European waste management the last 25 years. EPR could be, and that I agree with you, it could be the key to the circular economy. But in the same time, assessments carried out by the EU Commission, we have heard about it in former in conferences, in member states, and not at least if you ask the people around here, especially from cities, there are lots of bad stories about EPR introduced in the different member states. EPR is not a finally constructed roundabout within the circular economy. And everybody that has driven into a roundabout, think of Paris, Arc de Triomphe. If you drive into that roundabout around there, I don't know how you get out again. But so there could be fatal consequences of driving into a roundabout that is not functioning. But I think that the Commission has taken some consequences of this and introduced a set of guidelines in the proposed revised waste framework directive. As cities, we are actually applauding these guidelines. And we think that if EPR should be an instrument towards the circular economy, those guidelines introduced in the Waste Framework Directive is the bottom line, it's necessary. Differentiations of project fee, yes, we want that. Entire cost coverage, including optimized cost for municipalities, fantastic. If the cost of the municipalities could be covered, not all costs, but we decide on what cost could be covered, we are doing a huge step in the right direction. Adequate monitoring and enforcement framework, it's obvious, it should be there for ages. Necessary operational and financial means to meet extended producer obligations, it's fundamental requirements. EPR will help cities to develop a more ambitious waste management without stressing city financial resources, and they will send more correct signals to the producer of the responsibilities when designing new products to the market. And after listening to Nicolas, of course it should be enlarged to more projects. What we lack is including a partial responsibility for the cost of prevention and cleanup of littering. The pictures from Jakob Simonsen shows that a part of the environmental cost of all projects is that the part of it is ending up as littering. Why shouldn't that be covered also by the EPR systems? It was put forward in the 2014 recommendation in the annex to the VFD. It should be put back into the Waste Framework Directive, once again, the partial cost of the littering. EPR has the potential to become the most important tool to support quality recycling and maximizing material recovery if we use it in a good way. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. The previous two panelists have touched upon the EPR schemes, and I guess the reason why I'm sitting here was that I was leading the project on the separate collection, so I would like to reflect a little bit more on that, and I understand that's also the topic of this this panel. But I think I know the answer for Barbie's end of life. First of all, I think she lived happily ever after from the money she got from Ken after the divorce. So I think that's one is sorted out. Well, we have heard in the previous panel that there's no one size fits all. And I think the discussion also between the different treatment options have shown that there are actually issues that could be sorted out at a local level, and there are issues that would probably require legal changes, for example. So I think just to reflect on the discussion on the composition for Denmark, I think some of the valuable part of the waste is actually under an EPR scheme. So if you look at the composition of the materials in different cities, you would find that in Copenhagen, for example, in the study we made, you don't find a valuable plastics, which is in a different collection scheme. And we try to indeed compare the pears and the apples here because of these differences. So if, although Philip said there is no one recipe, what I try to do is to make a short recap on all the findings based on the case studies we had, and shortlist a number of candidate good ideas where to start from. And I think, first of all, it would be extremely important at the legal level, maybe European or national legislations, to clear up the definitions and the metrics, because it's still a mess. That could follow, of course, the clear allocation of the responsibilities between the private sector and the municipalities, how the municipal collection schemes can be aligned with the EPR and other private collection schemes. I think this also touches upon the fee system. Some is, of course, a local issue. Where do you raise funds for separate collection? Where do you raise funds for diverting waste from landfills or other sources? Or whether you consider the taxation of raw materials, for example. That's also another thing we have not touched upon. But I think if you look at the successful cities, it's very obvious that they have all started with source separation of paper. They proceeded with glass. I mean, paper is the second biggest fraction for sure. Glass would be the third one. Then you can try plastic and metal. probably source separation, but we maybe don't have to demonize, and I hope I'm not going to be shot for this sentence here, for the commingled collection of plastic and metal at the door-to-door systems as well. But if you want to have big gains in your recycling performance, then you should indeed deal with the bio-waste. I think, and this is maybe the last thing that I'd like to mention now, is the clear communication. Very often you would see that the municipalities say they have awareness-raising campaigns, and we have seen many of the good examples here today. But if you talk to people, even highly educated and committed people, very often they make mistakes with what should be sorted to which bin, or what kind of paper can be sorted out, actually, or if you have a pizza box with grease contamination, should that be sorted out? Should it be not? What is hard plastic? What is soft plastic? And so on. I think there are a lot of things that we take for granted and as understood, but I think, in fact, it's not necessarily understood widely. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, as a mere consumer or city-sumer or whatever we may be called, I would agree with that. I think you make a very good final point. Right, yes, thank you.
Thanks a lot, yeah. Quality recycling needs, I think, first good material that we can recycle. And quality recycling needs markets. So we need applications where we can recycle, especially the different kinds of plastics too. So for this we need to develop markets because we don't find them very often. So green, in brackets public procurement, green procurement might help here a lot to create these new markets for all the material we will have to collect and to recycle in the future. But now going back, of course, for good quality recycling, we need good material. We need enough material for the different fractions so that it makes sense to concentrate on them. And for the good material to be recycled, of course, we need good sorting plants, latest technology to sort out the right things. And we still have member states in Europe which believe that a sorting plant with a capacity of 10,000 tons a year and manual sorting can deliver the results that are needed for good quality recycling. I'm sorry, this is not possible. We have to move on. We have to use the latest automatic sorting technology to deliver the right quality for the recycling. But of course, you can only sort good quality. Anything else that does not make real sense. So to sort shit stays shit, to say it very frankly. So this is what we have to have a very convenient collection system for our inhabitants, a convenient one, an easy one that they understand. So you need to do a lot of communication as well. And I can only speak to my German colleagues. I think that they will agree. Up to 10 years ago, we had a very good communication to the public. The local authorities did their job, but then we had an overall additional campaign. Since 10 years, this had been stopped for several reasons, but it's important to see the results. Now, in the surveys, 80% of the people say they don't care what they thought. Imagine, Germans. So you see this, how important it is to run and to finance a good communication campaign. And for all of this, a good and convenient collection system, I think here's the place for packaging recovery organizations, for EPR systems. They can help together with the local authorities to build up such a good system. But you need a good legislation and enforcement to be able to run such system. And you see that we have some member states where you have first a good legislation and then second the good enforcement. And so the systems are able to deliver something. And if you go in other member states where you perhaps have a good legislation, but no one is enforcing them, and I would again look into my own home country, where there's a lot of possibility for improvement. Without enforcement, we can stop the whole thing. And you can still see after 10 years, 15 years of European Packaging Directive in the new member states, in many, you still have no functioning infrastructure for the collection. Although you have system here, there, although you have legislation there, but it is not good and not enforced. So I really appreciate the efforts of the European Commission to start with these minimum requirements for EPR, to have this best practice exchange platform. Perhaps really one day we will be able to learn from each other, we'll be brave enough to say, okay, my neighboring country did a good job, so let's take something from them as well.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you for swearing twice. That's stupendous. No, it's good. You don't have to do that. I like that. And can you imagine German? That was particularly good in your in there. So that was sort of, we need good sorting plants. There's not enough. There's not enough comms. We need enough material. So okay, that's your perspective there. Let's move on to Michael Len on my left. Are you going to swear?
I'll try not to.
Very good. Okay.
Okay, thanks very much. Just very briefly, some comments and some ideas that we're trying to promote concerning how to support the development of local reuse structures, you know, extending the product's lifetimes locally and also creating jobs locally. Well, for us, reuse organizations, they need access to reusable goods. They also need a collection and logistics system that preserves reuse value. So it's not just about recycling, it's about reuse value. But in order for this to happen, there needs to be real cooperation between all parties involved, cooperation between reuse centres and waste management companies, between municipalities as well, and also the EPR schemes. And we've seen in the past that extended producer responsibility has not been necessarily the best tool so far in terms of trying to promote waste prevention and reuse activities. At least this has been the case, for example, in WE, where we see that there are possibilities in good cooperation between reuse organisations and producer responsibility organisations, but it's all very much reliant on goodwill, and unfortunately not everyone is willing to cooperate. So what we're really trying to focus on is very much looking at separate targets for reuse, quantitative targets for preparation for reuse away from recycling, and they already exist in a number of countries, France, Spain, Flanders, okay, it's not a country, but they do exist at the moment. I think Europe should look to these examples to see, you know, how further they can promote the reuse activity locally. On extended producer responsibility, again, I would say it is one of these links, the links between waste management and also the way the product is designed. And it is interesting to see this addition from the Commission to look at trying to differentiate the EPR fees based on how the product is designed. You know, if it's more difficult to recycle, then it should have a higher fee. If it's easier to recycle, it should have a lower fee. Now, for us, we think it should also be extended to repair. We're seeing products are becoming increasingly difficult to repair, especially electronics and furniture. And it could be interesting to expand the scope to also look at the repairability of products. But this is not enough as well. I think, you know, one thing is, you know, concerning eco-design, I don't think we can put all our eggs into one basket when it comes to looking at waste legislation. I think other measures need to be in place as well. Things like zero VAT on repair activities, zero VAT, for example, on the sale of second-hand products. And what about possible repair-friendly criteria within eco-design measures? So these are some other things which we could also be looking to. And finally, what concerns us in particular, our association, we federate social enterprises working in the field of reuse and repair, it's very much for municipalities and also EPR schemes where implicated are to use social clauses in tendering procedures. I think this would really be very helpful to social organisations in this area to, you know, remain on the market. It's a competitive market, and it would really help in terms of also the added value for municipalities in terms of employment locally and also to the type of people that you're employing as well. So thank you very much.
Virginia, I'm glad to see a friendly female face up here. Thank you very much. Can you conclude?
Thank you. Just perhaps quickly to frame European for you. So European stands for the European Organization for Packaging and the Environment, and we represent the packaging supply chain, meaning raw material suppliers, packaging converters, and the producers, so the brand owners. It's just important when we discuss and debate about extended producer responsibility, which we have in European for the last 4, 5, 6 years. And we've become painfully aware as well, not only that there are different schemes and different implementation, but that we can't do it alone. And yes, in the strict sense, extended producer responsibility, we have the legal obligation in those national markets and member states who have EPR. but we can't do it alone. So there's of course the shared responsibility, and it has been touched upon by the other speakers and endorsed as well, that the roles and responsibilities of private waste management, public waste management, producers, the authorities, national authorities, consumers, let us not forget the consumers and citizens, all have their role to play, and these have to be set at national level according to those schemes. So that was the first point I wanted to make. The second point is actually, Michael, I'm so glad you just spoke before me. I want, on extended producer responsibility, we definitely will be very vigilant moving forward with the proposal and the circular economy package, that we can identify and distinct the different waste streams as well. Because we have the EPR minimum requirements, which we support as well, in the bigger waste framework directive. And we will have to make sure moving forward that whatever is being, what comes out next year or in 2 years' time, will also be, is still broad enough, but also meaningful also for the packaging waste stream. For instance, when you refer to repair, we just need to make sure, and we don't want to hold you back, Michael, and with textiles and we and the other waste streams, but it just has to be, make sure it's meaningful for us. Also, when we refer to products, packaging is part of a product, it's the weird one. I really liked the first speaker's comment that we were the best performers in class on EPR, so thank you very much for that endorsement. I don't have to say then. So that's definitely a second point that we would look out for, and that's also reflected in the new calculation methodology, the new targets, preparing for reuse / recycling. What does that mean for packaging specific versus products? So that's point two. And point three, if I still have time? Yeah? Well, actually, that's on the minimum requirements. I think the Commission did a fantastic job with what they have proposed in the Waste Framework Directive. I think this will help all of us, all of the stakeholders, to make sure that EPR is better, can be better implemented at national level. So we have the accountability there. There is a reference to the roles and responsibilities. We have the enforcement needs that will be better put in place, that will also avoid free riding, also from producer side, but also from scheme sides, or whoever is missing out or is free riding. And then the transparency will also be increased with those new proposals, which we also encourage, not only from the traceability and the material flows, but also the cost element, what producers pay into those schemes, but also how those schemes are managed all across Europe and all in all different models as well, to create that level playing field versus authorities, but also versus the obliged industry and the municipalities. Should I wrap up now? And on the cost element, et cetera, perhaps there's one little tweak we need to discuss still further with policymakers, where we would like to see more of an exhaustive list and also see how full net coverage, where producers are legally obliged, where it stops, where it begins and where it stops. So for how it's worded now, it seems like it's a non-exhaustive list, which scares industry, and I think it would scare every stakeholder who is confronted with a non-exhaustive list when it comes to paying up. But I would just want to end in a final note as well, that I'm really happy with this stakeholder consultation as well, and I believe very firmly that we're all in this together, and I look forward to increase the common understanding and be working better with you all in the future. Thank you.
So I asked the same questions I did the other panelists. Is there anything that any of you first would like to comment on from your... Yes?
I forget something important, I think. Do you think that it's logical that if you are a producer and you put on the market something, it's recyclable, you have to pay an eco-contribution, like an ERP? And if you put on the market something, it's not recyclable, you don't have to pay anything on waste. It's unlogical. And that's the reason why in France we are going to work on the tax, because Martin proposed that it would be forbidden to put on the market non-recyclable product. The other solution is to tax products which is not recyclable. It's more soft, softer, but in fact it could help us to finance the public services of waste, because incoherent to not to pay anything when you put on a market product without any solution for recycling.
Anybody else? Yes? Yeah?
Another point is also the former panel was talking about quality. I think EPR could be essential to quality. First of all, cities are waste management handling. They are taking care of waste, but produce a quality secondary raw material is extremely difficult from a waste management perspective. At the moment, we are responsible for this quality delivering to industry. I think EPR should be in the middle of that, identifying that quality and helping us to make this quality available for industry. And on the other hand, EPR could also be essential to us to demand the industry to put out projects that provide quality in recycling. If somebody is producing a packaging that is black and it's not recycled, then it should be the EPR system that was going back to their members or to their producers saying, stop it, find some other solutions. If we are going to have a circular economy, you can't produce this project. So EPR system should be made responsible for taking away projects in their system that are not recyclable. And that could be put into the requirements of the existing framework.
Okay, over to you. What do you think? Yes, the gentleman here.
Yeah, from the Italian Composting Association again. Let me get back just to provoke the audience and the panel as well. We are looking at the title, Maximize Material Recovery. So definitely we are talking about the most important fraction, and one of those is bio-waste. So again, talking about extended producer responsibility on bio-waste, what are we talking about? Who is the producer of an orange peel, of a banana peel? Should it be responsible for it improper disposable or not? This is the crucial question that, according to me, has not been addressed in the revised proposal of a Waste for More Directive. And so, what are the possible alternative incentive scheme that may be and should be put in place in order to subsidize bio-waste collection and treatment, as it has been done for all the other dry recyclables, because it was the original rationale of the beginning of the EPR schemes. Thank you.
Does anybody want to say about that? Would anybody like to come on that, make any suggestions? No? No, nobody wants to come back to you to say who is responsible for EPR and bio-waste and could there be another scheme? Yeah, oh, you do. This gentleman does.
Yeah, I agree with you in principle, but on the other hand, I think that food is one of the products that are clean all the way. So if we don't need EPR on the management of food. The problem is to make the food back again in the circle, back to the farmers that could actually use our contribution of fertilizers from our transforming of food or food waste back to fertilizers. I'm not sure that we really need a producer responsibility system to do that. I think there are other legal frameworks that are more important and a trust between those who are handling bio-waste in biogas plants and in composting plants and the farmers using fertilizer from us. So I think the problem is not, no, the answer of the problem to make fertilizer more available is not EPR. It's more dialogue between the value change. Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? Anybody else have a question? Yes, gentleman here.
I think one of the main ideas of producer responsibility was that the idea that the producers then produce products that are more easy to disassemble and to recycle. What are the panel's experience regarding this issue? Do we actually get better products? Do we see better products with EPR schemes? Are they easier to recycle when we have EPR schemes? Are they designed to split apart? My iPad, for example, here, I think the cost of the iPad is quite substantial compared with the cost of the EPR that is to go into this iPad. I don't think when they have designed it, they didn't look at the cost of disassembling this iPad. I cannot even change the battery in it.
Okay. So we talked about that, and it was actually commented on the panel that there are some bad stories about EPR member states. EPR needs to be used in the right way. So who would like to come back first to Jakob?
I totally agree with Jakob, because in fact we decided to make tax on landfill to change the work of the local authority. We decided to develop incentive tax to change the way to sort of the population. And in fact, the eco-contribution is probably not enough incentive to oblige or to encourage the producers to change their media to product. In fact, we know that we have about 20 different plastics in packaging. After 20 years ERP, it means that the eco-contribution didn't change the way they work because they have other constraints, I can understand. But in fact, we know that the eco-contribution didn't change really the way they have to product their packaging. So I totally agree with Jakob. We failed something on ERP, which not changing the work of the... We tried to make packaging lighter, I think, but we didn't encourage enough producer to change that sort of plastic to be sure that they are going to use plastic recyclable.
I think this comes to the old question. What is really important for the society? The recycling or the environmental footprint of the packaged product? Because we do not use and design packaging just with a focus whether it is recyclable or not. It has several other functions, and very often some packaging materials which are at the moment more difficult to recycle than others fulfill so many other good functions, save so much energy, increase the shelf life, etc., etc., that this covers 10 times, 100 times the perhaps more environmental damage from the non-recyclability. I think we are concentrating too much on the recyclability issue and should discuss the environmental footprint of the packaged product, because this is in the end what we want, to decrease the environmental footprint of a packaged product.
I think, again, directly trying to answer your question as well. Yes, you had the iPhone in your hand, but I can only talk about the packaging waste stream. I think this is what we're trying to achieve now with stronger EPR rules and minimum requirements, which will then come into the member states as well. If we have better enforcement and more transparency in the cost and material flows, where everything is going and who pays for what, definitely the incentives will be more exposed and will be increasing, and that will actually more and more close the loop as well, especially also on the recyclability. I can tell from my membership as well, all those companies, they are looking into the circular economy and the separate collection and the EPR systems valid for their specific packaged product supply chains. But it's actually brilliant times for the industry. So. And this is what we're also, with the policy framework, are trying to achieve as well, so that the increased recyclability and with the transparency, et cetera, and EPR.
Yeah, I mean, just maybe coming back to that point of the inclusion of the differentiated fees for the way products are designed. I think it's only France at the moment which is doing it, at least for a number of waste streams, and I think the proposal is running kind of in line with what's happening in France. I mean, what concerns us in terms of goods that you find around your house, electronics, furniture, textiles, etc., when it comes to extended producer responsibility, it doesn't, in most countries, it doesn't tackle a lot of these product categories. It's only, again, in France where there are EPR schemes, national EPR schemes for example, textiles and for furniture. It doesn't exist elsewhere. So in the absence of those EPR schemes for those product types, how else could you potentially
tackle the design issue in terms of design for disassembly, design for reuse, etc. So, I mean, we've been looking at, you know, green public procurement, etc., and it suddenly always, well, seems to always go back towards, you know, the business model of the company as well. I mean, it also goes round to looking at many, you know, product service systems, etc. So I think, you know, I think we can't use EPR, I think, to solve all the problems in terms of the design. It can go a long way. I think it can go a long way, but I think it's part of, there'll be a package of measures to do that.
Yes.
Once again, I agree with Jakob. And I think if you do the same as Helmut Mora said, that there is something in the communication from the Commission, but it's hidden and it's not used enough. They are saying on the consumption and production that we could use the EPR as a tool and it could be developed that way, and eco-design is something as well, but it's not concrete and they have not dared to put it actually into the framework directive where it could be, or in developing of the eco-design directive using EPR as a tool or instrument there as well. So there is a potential, it's mentioned by the Commission and they will come back to it, but they have not used the opportunity of this circular economy package to actually launch EPR as a tool for making projects more recyclable or more eco-effective or resource efficient.
Gentleman in the front row, our final speaker in a bit.
So my name is Julio García Burgués, head of the Waste Management Unit in the environment. I will be delivering the closing statement, but before I deliver my closing statement, I would like to make a first one comment and secondly ask a question to the panel. So my comment, I'm very happy that our legislative proposal and the general requirements that we have proposed for the development of EPR schemes have been welcomed, that they are generally considered as a useful instrument, but reacting a little bit to what Mr. Garnier has said, well, let's be clear, there is something called subsidiarity, and at European level there is a limit to what we can do and to what we should be doing. I don't think that establishing a universal requirement to set up EPR schemes is the right approach, and I don't think that setting up a very detailed requirements at EU level is the right approach either. There are many different models out there. There are many different EPR schemes in the 28 member states, and well, I don't think that everything should be harmonized in Brussels. My question, which I think is really crucial. A couple of weeks ago, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation has issued a report on plastic waste, which highlights something which is emerging as a global environmental issue. Marine plastic litter. According to this report, if nothing is done, in 50 years we will have, by 2050, we will have as much plastic as fish in the oceans. And, well, in particular, plastic packaging is a fundamental ingredient of marine plastic litter. Is there something that can be done through EPR schemes to address this problem, which again is emerging as a global environmental problem? And I think that our children will have to deal with the mess that we are creating today.
Yes?
Definitely. EPR schemes could support cities to develop the waste collection systems. Waste collection systems will prevent, better waste best, collection system will prevent littering. Littering is a part of what's especially plastic going into the ocean by rivers, by the seaside. So better waste management systems are a key to prevent littering. And EPR system covering optimized cost could help to that. The second one was what was missing in the EPR requirements in the VFD. They should be partly responsible for financing, for cleaning, and prevention of EPR for littering. I think that's essential for it. As it is now, littering is strictly responsibilities for city or municipalities or shops, a little bit like that. But if we are going to have good systems to prevent littering, both by communication, by more bins, by cleaning up activities, somebody has to pay for it. And I don't think cities with stressed financial situations are able to do this, to solve this big problem. But if we have it together with the EPR systems, yes, we can do it.
I think there is a huge ambiguity in our discussion on ERP. I think we focus on ERP schemes, but I must say that ERP scheme is not the only solution. But I can't imagine that the directive says something like you can make ERP, because the responsibility of the producer is evident in each product. I think in that pen there is a responsibility of the producers. In that there is a responsibility. I can't imagine that a European directive say on that product, I don't know, or on that, there is no responsibility of the producer of that glass or plastic glass. So the question is, on the directive, we can put something like a universally responsibility of the producers. I hope that we can write that. But I can understand that you can't say, and you are going to make a scheme in each country, in each goods. But I think one of the most important issues of that directive is to say, is there producer responsibility on that, on that, on that, on that, and so on. And I can't imagine that the directive say, we don't know, do it yourself. That's a problem.
Thank you. I think it's also important to reflect on the history of EPR schemes and why they were set up, both in relation to the discussion whether it should be the product design and the repairability of an iPad on the one hand, or cleaning up the littering on the one, on the other side. Because I think we have to appreciate that EPRs traditionally have performed well in establishing collection schemes on product types, maybe packaging or e-waste, electronic waste, for example, where previously it was a problematic area, and it all led to the economy of scales. And that's the last part of the question in the panel here, is to maximize the material recovery. And I think one of the issue here is always the economy of scales. May it be the cleanup of littering, may it be the management of e-waste. And I think I agree with Håkan on that it could be a solution to earmark some money, may it be from EPR schemes, from waste taxation, may it be the sales on the plastic bags itself, because also to a big extent it's not littering from Europe necessarily what you would find in the Mediterranean, but cleaning up is of course a joint responsibility in that. But I think, and this is something I wanted to mention, is that because we all heard that what should not be put into EU legislation, I'd like to point out to one issue, a problem that I think stems from European legislation and partially plays against the economy of scales, and that's the proximity and the self-sufficiency principles that partially prevent countries to design waste management plans that allow them to find the markets for what they collect separately, maybe electronic waste or materials we talk about here, plastics, glass, and so on. So I think, just to conclude, we shouldn't expect EPR to solve everything, for sure.
Yeah, well, I support the previous speakers as well, but of course there is a role equally, or for EPR as well, where we can contribute within a controlled cost element as well, where we are clear where the cost starts and begins, and where we can have some leverage as well on information campaigns together with the municipalities or in the framework of EPR, and it's also in the proposal, information to waste holders. So not only how they have to collect or separately collect, but there can be also some awareness campaigns on littering prevention. But the difficult one is this shared responsibility, the behavioral issue, and how to tackle the sustainable consumption part as well of consumers and citizens. And there I think I've noted down the Commissioner Vella this morning as well, speaking about putting the circular economy into the schooling system as well, so where we start from an early age as well to create this awareness within the youngsters and then move forward from there. And we'll have to tackle it from many, many areas, but there is also, of course, where we can contribute via EPR. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, last speaker.
Yes. I would like to underline the international dimension of this, because I think we are within the European Union already doing quite a lot. Of course, we can improve, but we are doing something. And this has already a quite positive effect to many neighboring countries. See all the Balkan states, which are not in the EU, but they still try to improve the waste management system. But I don't know, probably many of you have seen two years ago the film Trashed from Jeremy Irons, kindly presented by Potocnik in the Parliament, where you could see what is happening on the other side of the Mediterranean Sea, where they build a landfill directly at the Mediterranean Sea. So the landfill is never full, because with every wave they take something like this. So I have sometimes the feeling that we are trying to cycle up a very high mountain, but whatever we do, as long as the other side is doing nothing like today, we will fail. So we give so many financial aid to other countries. Can we not somehow bind it, somehow motivate them to invest in waste management as well?
I wanted to add one more thing which I forgot to say, and I mentioned it today because somebody of the speakers referred to it, and penalties for littering. I mean, we can't forget that this is littering is an illegal act. So I think, like they're doing in Singapore, it's a very clean city. Penalties in regard of littering could also be an option to explore.
Yes, can I give the last question to you? It's
sorry, Katrina. No, I actually want to come back to what Joachim had said, but you added something very important there, which was part of my statement in your last statement, and that is that on the one hand, we have to look at packaging not as just the package, but the whole product. So packaging has a purpose. And so on the one hand, we're looking at it as its whole environmental footprint. But because Europe is an example to the rest of the world, because the rest of the world does follow what we do, what we put in our legislation, how we recycle, how we reuse, I'm going to ask you a question back. If we, EPR systems and producers together and the European legislation, push towards more recyclability of products, meaning that when they are waste, they have a resale value, meaning that even if they are the other side of the world where there is no waste management system, that product, that waste, will be collected and it will be resold to the market, and this happens in Mexico, it happens in Africa, there are waste pickers, and they sell it to the market and it gets recycled. Whatever is not recyclable, and this happens in Europe too, goes into a dump site, unmanaged, there is no waste management, and that is where we have the problem, because the wind and the rain and the sea, because a lot of these dump sites are on the seaside, comes up and washes them into the sea. And that is where our plastics in the oceans comes from. Plastic in the ocean does not come from good waste management systems. Thank you.
You've cowed him. He doesn't want to. Now, really, this is the very... Is this a comment or is this a question? Please, sir. It's a comment. Okay, the final...
I think the example from Mr. Bokas is extremely scary. industrial production of plastic started in the 1950s. And what Booker's is saying is that there's documentation that in 2050 there will be as much plastic in the oceans as there will be fish. So in the span of only 100 years, we managed to pollute the planet to just incredible dimensions. I think what we are talking about, producer responsibilities, can we remedy the problem with this instrument? No, we cannot. Can we remedy the problem with more recycling? No, we cannot. I think we need to step up and look at other kinds of regulating these kind of substances in our society that is undesirable. Maybe we should start saying that we don't want plastic anymore. In the span of next 20 years, let's stop the production of plastics. There are subsidies for plastics. You have bioplastics. Why not? I don't think we can. Just the velocity of the problem is just nearly not comprehensible.
Okay. Well, that's a question that you leave us with. I'm going to close things now. Thank you very much. I think there's a tremendous amount to take away. Either you were all very tired or too cowed or just very, very happy to listen to these good people. So I can release you, actually, and I'm going to come down in a moment myself. Virginia, Michal, Joachim, Martin, Hakon and Nicola, thank you very much. A round of applause, please. Thank you. And in fact, could you give me some humming music while I come down as well, all on my lonesome? So, you've already introduced yourself pretty much, haven't you, Julio? You are shortly going to be released into the cool air and go out there either home or enjoy an evening in Brussels. But before you do, I'd like to invite a last speaker to the podium to warm you up as you go out into the cold with a few closing remarks. Please could you put your hands together for Julio Garcia Berges, who is Head of Unit Waste Management Recycling. You can start to clap. DG Environment, European Commission. And now you may start to clap. Thank you.
So. First of all, a piece of good news. I know that it's late, that you are tired, that it's been a very long day, and that you are anxious to go home and to start your weekend. So, although according to the program, I have 10 minutes for my closing statement, I won't be taking all of that time. I will be much shorter. Certainly, I won't try to summarize what has been said today. I would just like to highlight two main ideas. First, all we have heard points in a clear direction. Separate collection is the key to move towards circular economy and to achieve the objectives set out in the 7th Environmental Action Program. Without effective separate collection systems, it will not be possible to reduce landfilling and to meet the recycling targets in EU legislation. And as has been said several times today, we have not only the current recycling targets, but also much more ambitious recycling targets proposed by the European Commission. Secondly, I believe that today we have managed to dispel three basic misconceptions about separate collection. Separate collection is too costly, separate collection is not favored by the public, and separate collection cannot work properly in big cities or in smaller ones. The evidence that we have got today shows, first, that if properly designed, separate collection systems are much more cost-effective than other systems. Secondly, that the level of social acceptance and support is very high if households are given the right incentives. And incidentally, I was really excited about this example in Ljubljana, this kind of sort and get your money back that they have been implementing. Thirdly, and this is something I think extremely important, separate collection is a flexible tool. Separate collection systems can be adapted to meet local needs and operate very effectively, equally effective, effectively in big cities and in small ones. So I think that simply these three key findings are worth justify the time we have spent here together. If you allow me 2 more minutes, I would like to thank all those who have helped us to set up this event, which is in fact the culmination of a longer project. Thanks to BIPRO, thanks to the partners, to our partners in Municipal Waste Europe and in Eurocities, and big thanks to our BOSI moderator. Thanks to her, we are finishing on time. To all the speakers, to the panelists, and to all of you for taking an active part in the discussions we have had today. And finally, that's my last word, congratulations to Ljubljana, Tallinn and Helsinki. Congratulations on their performance, the work done to develop efficient separate collection systems. This is not a beauty contest, but certainly their example will be inspiring for all of us. Thank you very much.
You've done a lot of my thank you, so that's very good. I'd also like to thank the speakers, because actually, if you take away the coffee break and the lunchtime, that was 32 speakers in 6 hours, which works out at about 5 1/3, I don't know what a third of a speaker is, per hour. So thank you very, very much. Firstly, to those organisers that you have already thanked, and also, of course, thank you so much for you guys. So for everybody, I think, I hope that the ones who left early was only because they had planes and trains to catch. So thank you so much for sticking with us throughout the day. It can be tough in the afternoon in this room when you're full of food. So thanks to you all. And also to our interpreters. I've never had somebody say in my ear, oh, for goodness sake, please, could you get that person to slow down? So that was a new experience for me. But honestly, I don't know how you do it. It's absolutely remarkable. Appreciate very much your questions. I hope you found the content informative. It was incredibly wide-ranging. I hope that you will benefit from the networking opportunity. That's the whole point. I have been told that you will be able to access photos online in the coming day or so, and an executive summary of the conference will be available in a couple of weeks. So do look out for that. As you know, the PowerPoints, as I said already, will be available on Monday online. So until the next time, I do wish those of you here with me, and of course those of you who are about to switch off your computer, you might have already gone to the pub, I don't know, a very,